ang talagang kinik niya. Oh, as in sobrang ay as
Hi everyone. Okay, unahan ko na kayo. It's late. I know it's December. Merry Christmas. Super na-enjoy ko lang yung pagbabasa ko ng mga nakakatakot, nakakadiri, mga suspense from October to November. So without further ado, here are the books that I read. The first read is Mga Nilalang Nakagilagilalas ni Ginoong Edgar Calabia Samar. Ang Mga Nilalang Nakagilagilalas ay isang koleksyon ng iba't ibang nilalang in the Philippine folklore, Philippine mythology. Yung iba sa kanila, lagi natin naririnig sa mga kwento sa atin nung mga bata tayo. Mga laman lupa, mga aswang, mga anito, mga bayani na tanyag dito sa Pilipinas. The first thing that I like about this book is that it mentioned those familiar creatures. But then, 90% of all the creatures in here, I swear, hindi ko pa sila narinig ever. And hindi ko rin alam na ganun yung itsura nila, or at least yun yung interpretation ng artist. It was really such an educational experience, if I may say. And the second thing na nagustuhan ko is, finally, nagkapangalan na yung mga kababalaghan na naririnig ko lang noon. Nilagay din dito ni Ginoong Edgar Samar at ng kanyang team kung ano ba yung ginagawa ng mga creatures na to, paano sila papatayin, ano karaniwan yung mga gusto nilang kinakain. So for example, yung pinaka-interesting for me is yung ang busaw. Tama ba? Ang busaw. So that is what it looks like. What they look like. Bigla akong naalala yung kwento nung professor ko nung college. Sabi niya, sa probinsya daw nila, nakakita siya ng bangkay na naging kahoy. Are you familiar with the belief na parang pagka meron daw kayong patay, lalo na sa mga probinsya, you have to make sure na yun talaga yung bangkay nung kapamilya nyo or kakilala nyo. Kasi minsan, kinukuha sila ng mga elemento. Pinapalitan nila yung bangkay, ginagawa nilang kahoy. Sa tingin natin, yun pa rin yung bangkay nung namayapa. Pero ang totoo niyan, kahoy na lang siya. So, pinapalitan ng mga busaw ng katawan ng puno ng saging ang bangkay na kinukuha nila. Nagawa nila itong kamukha ng ninakaw na bangkay. So, when I read that, I was like, yun pala yung tawag doon. Yung mga nilalang na ito ay nanggaling sa mga kwentong bayad. So, yung mga pinasapasan na ng mga kwento ng kababalaghan, hindi natin alam. Maybe some of them were just stories used by colonizers to scare us, you know? Or used by men to scare women from going out. We don't know. Sinama niya din yung tawag sa mga nilalang na to mula sa iba't ibang etnikong grupo sa Pilipinas. Super ganda nung mga illustration. So, I'll show you the illustration of the Manananggal. I mean, girl, kaya pa ba? That's me during finals week. And they were also drawn by different artists. What made me fall in love with this book, with this author, made me look at my love for horror in a whole different way, is the introduction written by Sir Edgar Samar. Sinama niya yung transcript niya sa isang TED Talk na ginawa niya before. And the title nun is Kung Bakit Kailangan Nating Matakot. Isa sa mga tanong na tinry niyang sagutin is, bakit nga ba ang hilig natin gumawa at makinig, magpakwento ng mga kwentong katatakutan? Takot na takot ka na, pero gusto mo pa rin makinig. And that's me, ganun ako lumaki. Sabi niya na, importante yung mga ganitong kwento, diba? Importante yung mga kwento ng mga aswang, mga tikbalang, kasi yung mga nilalang na to ang nagsisilbing urian ng ating pagkatao. Pagka humaharap tayo sa mga nilalang na to, sa mga kinatatakutan natin, ang inaalam talaga natin ay kung ano tayo bilang tao. Dahil sa mga kwentong katatakutan, alam mo yun, buhay natin yung nakataya eh. Kung may nagkwento tungkol sa aswang, syempre matatakot tayo kasi pwede tayong masaktan. Pwedeng masaktan yung mga mahal natin sa buhay. Alam natin kung ano yung nakataya. Kaya tayo patuloy na gumagawa ng mga kwentong ganito, nakikinig sa mga kwentong ganito, kasi tinutulungan nila tayong alamin kung ano yung hangganan natin bilang tao. Ang ganda. Yung mga nilalang dito, hinati-hati niya. So, may mga laman lupa, may mga halimaw. So, tinry niya din bigyan ng mas malalim na kahulugan yung paggawa natin ng kwento tungkol sa mga hindi natin nakikita. I'm not gonna share everything. I don't know if yung TED Talk niya ay available sa YouTube, but it's also, it's here, the whole transcript is here, so if you wanna know more about it, I suggest you get this book. Yung pagsusulat natin ng mga istoryang ito, pagkakatha natin ng mga istoryang ito tungkol sa mga hindi natin nakikita ay nagpapaalala sa atin na mapanganib, no, yung paniniwala sa isang mundong lubhang pragmatiko, a very material world na ang pinaniniwalaan mo lang, ang binibigyan mo lang ng halaga ay yung mga nakikita mo. Nakatuon lang ang pansin natin sa mga konkretong realidad, sa mga konkretong bagay. And, you know, that's something really dangerous because a lot of the more important things in life are things we cannot see. Pag lumalabas tayo or nasa may damuhan tayo, sa may mga garden, sa kagubatan, lagi tayong nagsasabi ng tabi-tabi po. Kasi feeling natin meron tayong nagagambala na kung anong elemento dyan. In that sense, nagiging aware tayo, nagiging vigilant tayo dun sa mga hindi natin nakikita. At hindi lang yung mga katatakutan yung pinupunto nun eh. Kundi iba pang mga bagay na dapat nating bigyan din ng pansin. Another thing that he said was that, natatakot ka, so what? Doon sa mga sinusulat niya, pinupunto rin nun na parang kung natatakot ka, kailangan mong kumilos. Yung takot mo, kailangan mo siyang gawing pagkilos. That's exactly what he was trying to illustrate in the Janus Silang series. That, you know, you also have to remember that when you're acting upon your fear, pagka kikilos ka na para mapagtagumpayan yung kinatatakutan mo, hindi mo kailangan kumilos mag-isa. Sabi niya rin na ang mga bayan ay naitatag dahil sa pagtugon ng mga tao sa kinatatakutan ng bawat isa. Pinapaalalahan lang nila tayo na kailangan nating kumilos, kailangan nating makialam, mas manindigan, no, para sa, hindi lang para sa buhay natin, dahil hindi lang naman yun ang nakataya, kundi para sa buhay ng iba. I mean, Sir Edgar Summer for President. Joke lang, Lenny for President. So, the second book is The Doll Factory by Elizabeth MacNeil. This one is a really good read kasi it's a gothic thriller, historic thriller, and I learned so much about Victorian London na hindi talaga ako familiar with that era aside from, you know, watching Downton Abbey, mga ganyan. And The Doll Factory, mainly we follow Iris. She is a doll maker, so she works in this doll factory with her sister Rose. It was a custom before na pagka kunwari merong may birthday or merong celebration yung isang tao, isa sa mga pwede mong iregalo sa kanila ay manika na kagaya nila or parang based sa kanila. What? Na ginawa para sa kanila. That time, hindi lang naman mga celebrations na ganun. Yung mga manika na yun, pinapagawa din to honor the dead. So their daily work is to look at the portraits of the people that they have to make dolls of. Hinuhulaan nila minsan kung patay na ba yun or buhay ba yun. Kasi diba, meron din silang custom before na they take pictures of the dead looking like they're still alive. So, I don't know, it's just, I like that. We follow another character named Silas. He's just so creepy from the very beginning. He's a taxidermist. He's in his cellar. He's locked in there. It's a very suffocating and enclosed world, and he takes the bodies of dead animals and then he stuffs them and displays them, parang ganun. And he collects a lot of exotic things. We follow another character named Louise. He is a painter. He's a member of the Pre-Raphaelite Brothers na hindi ko rin alam until I read about this. It's a controversial movement, a controversial group of painters during that time. It's all about power. It's all about obsession. It's all about delusion. It's also super grotesque. There are so many morbid scenes in here. You know, the characters are also very dynamic, especially Iris. Meron akong gustong-gustong line na sinabi niya. I spent all my life so careful not to encourage men, but also not to slight them. That speaks volumes of what women went through before and also go through now. Another thing is it illustrated the stark contrast between models and the paint. Things, the paintings that were made of them also follow the life of models. If you're a model of a painter, it's frowned upon. You're seen as a wasted woman. Wala ka ng dignidad, ganun. Kasi I think it's assumed that you're having romantic relations, premarital relations. You can't be a painter, you can't be a model. It's just, what now? You will be painted as a queen, as a princess, and then it will be exhibited. People from all around the world, the nobles, the rich people, will marvel at the painting and how beautiful the woman is. But the model in life is, you know, treated very poorly. It's low down towards the end. But then, you know, the ending, I liked it. I feel like the notions built during the first parts of the book, it counteracts those notions about women, about love, and about power. And I really like it. So I'm glad I read this book for October. So yeah, that is The Doll Factory. Next book. So this book is Nothing But Black and Teeth, and it's nothing but a bunch of... Ang ganda-ganda pa naman ng cover niya. Like, see? Like, diba? Parang it's super scary, super creepy. But the story is... it didn't do anything. It didn't do anything to me at all. I wanted to be scared. Actually, nakalimutan ko na yung story. But it's also a very short story. It's a novella. We follow these group of friends who went into this haunted Japanese mansion of the Heian era. I'm not sure if I'm pronouncing correctly. For a destination wedding. So two of them are getting married and they're going to celebrate it. And if I'm not mistaken, they were really fond of going to haunted houses and ghost hunting before. So decided na for this wedding, they're gonna go to this haunted Japanese mansion. And this mansion also has its tales, its urban legend. Mayroong ghost bride na nalibing daw dito sa mansion na to. And every year, she gets a sacrifice. And it's almost 100 years since. So parang nagiging 100th sacrifice na yung kukunan niya for this year. So it's forgettable. The plot was just... It was so awful. As in, sa start, parang you have these group of friends who are into petty fights. There were so many petty fights na parang this person had the past with that guy, and so there's tension between her and the girl of that guy. It's just, I don't need that drama. The only thing I liked about this is the cover. It's amazing. It's a work of art. The next book that I read for the month of November, kasi ito yung pinaka-last ata kasi hinintay ko pa siya dumating. This is Waking the Dead and Other Stories by Yvette Tan. You can see my laptop. This is a collection of short stories with a blurb from John Lloyd Cruz. Di mo ibababa. Well, John Lloyd Cruz, you're wrong. Just kidding. Waking the Dead was published, I think, years ago, and this is the new edition from Anvil Publishing. And it's a collection of 10 short stories, I think mostly in the speculative fiction genre. And there's mythology, there's supernatural creatures, there's just plain murder, there is just all those elements in one. It's not your usual jump scare. You won't get scared, but it doesn't mean you won't be disturbed because there are a lot of disturbing things in here. A woman is irresistibly drawn to the polluted Pasig River. A couple finds a baby on their doorstep that may not be human. Author of this book receives random phone calls from her dead father. That's one of my favorite stories. Kasi yung character is si Miss Yvette Tan herself. You know, most of the time, whenever I read short story collections, by Filipino authors. They present these stories as horror, but then it's not your typical definition of horror. So they're redefining what horror means. It makes you question what you are really afraid of, what horror really is for you. Is it the monsters themselves or the people, the humans? Same goes, diba? Katulad dun sa mga nilalang nakagilagilalas. Hindi lang naman itong mga nilalang na to yung kinatatakutan natin, but it actually speaks more of us as humans, right? Saan ka ba matatakot sa mga multo or yung, you know, nasa malakan niya? Joke lang. Her short stories also have political undertones and I really like that. So I like Child Abandon. That is yung a young woman is irresistibly drawn to this Pasig River to the point that she's drinking the water. I mean, finals week din niya ba? The other story is Daddy. And it's about the author receiving phone calls from her dead father. And I was just like, daddy issues. Next, yung Sidhi, it's about this god who has this effect of a drug. Parang he can put people in this high state. Goals. Just kidding. No. What I like about this book, number one, yung writing ni Ma'am Yvette. I just love her. I like her writing, safe to say. There are also gender issues in here. I mean, you know, not really discussed explicitly, but still, it's there. What did I not like? Usually when I read short stories, they leave me speechless. They stay with me. That's why I like reading short stories, because it has this ability to leave such a huge impact on you on such a short amount of time. So parang saglit mo lang binabasa, but it's going to stay with you for so many days. I did not feel that with this book. But the plots are not forgettable. The plots are not forgettable. It's just that, what now? Parang ganun, medyo nakakabitin siya. And at the same time, parang I had to reread to get to what she's pointing at. Like, I don't know what you want me to feel. Something like that. It's just not clear for me. I still think this is worth your time. Don't expect the creepy horror in this book. Hindi siya nakakatakot in that sense. Terrifying. Terrifying stories about our society. Last book that I read is also siguro my top two. First yung mga nilalang nakagilagilalas, and second is this one. It's Blindness by Jose Saramago. Grabe, sobrang ganda nito. Super page turner niya, hindi ko rin siya nababa. Kahit yung writing ni Jose Saramago is yung tuloy-tuloy. Sometimes you don't know who is speaking, you don't know who is thinking. But still, I still got it. Like, my brain cells got it. In Blindness, we follow a bunch of characters who were suddenly stricken by the white blindness epidemic. Ang bigla ka na lang mabubulag. All of a sudden, so while you're driving your car, while you're doing something intimate in bed, it's just in different scenarios, bigla na lang silang nabulag. And the government, like most governments, don't know what to do about it. Hindi nila alam kung paano siya na napapasa, kung nakakahawa ba siya, if it's just random, they don't know. So their first instinct is to gather all these people who suddenly went blind and put them in quarantine in this old asylum and just leave them there. Kasi sobrang lala talaga nung mga scenarios dito. And trigger warning din pala, there's sexual violence in here and a lot of grotesque scenes. Una, I was like, grabe, ang lala naman ng gobyerno to. Like, iiwan lang nila yung mga tao to fend for themselves. But then I was like, wait. Familiar. Super lala. As in, super lala. Basically, you have a bunch of, you know, hundreds of people in this building who are all blind. And, you know, paano sila matutulog? Paano sila matutulog? What? Paano sila kakain? Paano sila lalabas? Paano sila maliligo? It's just, ang lala. It's really a story of survival, but it's also a story about the different horrors. Yun nga, in the 20th century, in the 21st century, there's so much power play still dun sa lugar na yon. Like, even if hindi na sila nakakita, even if the situation was really at its worst, people will still try to overpower the others. Exceptional writing, exceptional story. You would feel the suffering of the characters, as in, oh my god. And again, trigger warning, some of the lessons, because I took this horror writing class parang a few months back, and sabi doon, you know, whenever you write horror stories, you have to think of a good or something good that you're going to take away from the main character, and for you to elevate the tension or parang the terror. Sometimes, you know, you play around with the background of the character, the connection of that background with that good. In this scenario, the good was yung sight, yung eyesight, right? We have a character who is an ophthalmologist, a doctor for the eyes, and he suddenly went blind. So those were the books that I read from October to November. Thank you so much for watching, and I'll see you in my next video. Bye-bye!